William Morrow and Harper Audio present Secrets of a Summer Night, The Wallflowers, Book 1, by Lisa Kleypas, performed by Rosalyn Landor. Chapter 1. London, 1843. The End of the Season. A marriage-minded girl could overcome practically any obstacle except the lack of a dowry. Annabelle swung her foot impatiently beneath the frothy white mass of her skirts while she kept her expression composed. During her past 3 failed seasons, she had become accustomed to being a wallflower. Accustomed, but not resigned. More than once, it had occurred to her that she deserved far better than to sit at the side of the room in a spindly chair, hoping, hoping, hoping for an invitation that would never come, and trying to pretend that she didn't care, that she was perfectly happy to be watching others dancing and being courted. Letting out a long sigh, Annabelle fiddled with a tiny silver dance card that hung from a ribbon on her wrist. The cover slid open to reveal a book of near-translucent ivory leaves that spread out in a fan. A girl was supposed to pencil the names of her dance partners on those delicate slips of ivory. To Annabelle, the fan of empty cards seemed to resemble a row of teeth, grinning at her mockingly. Snapping the silver case shut, she glanced at the 3 girls who sat next to her, all endeavouring to look similarly unconcerned with their fates. She knew exactly why they were there. Miss Evangeline Jenner's considerable family fortune had been made from gambling, and her origins were common. Moreover, Miss Jenner was painfully shy and possessed a stutter, which made the prospect of conversation a session of torture for both participants. The other 2 girls, Miss Lillian Bowman and her younger sister Daisy, had not yet become acclimated to England, and from the looks of things, it would take them a long time. It was said that the Bowman's mother had brought the girls from New York because they hadn't been able to get any suitable offers there. The soap bubble heiresses, they were mockingly referred to, or occasionally, the dollar princesses. Despite their elegantly angled cheekbones and tip-tilted dark eyes, they would find no better luck here unless they could find an aristocratic sponsor to vouch for them and teach them how to fit in with British society. It occurred to Annabelle that in the past few months of this miserable season, the 4 of them, herself, Miss Jenner, and the Bowmans, had often sat together at balls or soirees, always in the corner or against the wall, and yet they had rarely spoken to each other, trapped in the silent tedium of waiting. Her gaze caught that of Lillian Bowman, whose velvety, dark eyes contained an unexpected gleam of humour.
"At least they could have made the chairs more comfortable," Lillian murmured, "when it's obvious we're going to occupy them all evening." "We should have our names engraved on them," Annabelle replied wryly. "After all the time I've spent in it, I own this chair."
A muffled giggle came from Evangeline Jenner, who lifted a gloved finger to push back a vivid red curl that had fallen over her forehead. The smile made her round blue eyes sparkle, and her cheeks turn pink beneath a scattering of gold freckles. It seemed that a sudden sense of kinship had temporarily caused her to forget her shyness.
It makes no sense that you're a wallflower, she told Annabelle. You're the most beautiful girl here. Men should be falling all over themselves to dance with you.
Annabelle lifted her shoulder in a graceful half shrug.
No one wants to marry a girl without a dowry.
It was only in the fantasy realm of novels that dukes could marry poor girls. In reality, dukes and viscounts and the like were burdened with the massive financial responsibility of maintaining large estates and extended families and helping the tenantry. A wealthy peer needed to marry into money just as badly as a poor one did.
No one wants to marry a nouveau riche American girl either, Lillian Bowman confided. Our only hope of belonging anywhere is to marry a peer with a solid English title.
But we have no sponsor,
her younger sister Daisy added. She was a petite, rather elfin version of Lillian, with the same fair skin,
heavy, dark hair and brown eyes. An impish smile touched her lips.
If you happen to know of some nice duchess who would be willing to take us under her wing, we would be much obliged. I don't even want to find a husband,
Evangeline Jenner confided.
I'm merely suffering through the season because there is nothing else for me to do. I'm too old to stay at school any longer, and my father...
She broke off abruptly and sighed.
Well, I have only one more season to go, then I'll be 23 and a confirmed spinster. How I'm looking forward to it. Is 23 the measure of spinsterhood these days?
Annabelle asked with half-feigned alarm. She rolled her eyes heavenward.
Good Lord, I had no idea that I was so far past my prime. How old are you?
Lillian Bowman asked curiously. Annabelle cast a glance to the right and left to make certain they were not being overheard.
25 next month.
The revelation earned 3 rather pitying glances, and Lillian replied consolingly,
You don't look a day more than 21.
Annabelle clutched her fingers around her dance card until it was concealed in her gloved hand. Time was slipping away quickly, she thought. This, her 4th season, was drawing rapidly to a close, and one simply did not embark on a 5th season. It would be ludicrous. She had to catch a husband, and soon. Otherwise, they could no longer afford to keep Jeremy at school, and they would be forced to move from their modest terrace and find a boarding house to reside in. And once the downhill slide began, there was no climbing back up. In the 6 years since Annabelle's father had died of a heart ailment, the family's financial resources had dwindled to nothing. They had tried to camouflage their increasingly desperate straits, pretending they had a half dozen servants instead of one overworked cookmaid and an aging footman, turning their faded gowns so that the underside of the fabric was facing outward, selling the stones in their jewellery and replacing them with paste. Annabelle was heartily tired of their constant efforts to deceive everyone, when it seemed that everyone already knew they were on the brink of disaster. Lately, Annabelle had even begun to receive discreet offers from married men, who told her, meaningfully, that she had only to ask for their help and it would be given immediately. There was no need to describe the compensations that such help would require. Annabelle was well aware that she had the makings of a first-rate mistress.
Miss Peyton, Lillian Bowman asked, what kind of man would be the ideal husband for you?
Oh, Annabelle said with irreverent lightness,
any peer will do.
Any peer?
Lillian asked skeptically.
What about good looks?
Annabelle shrugged.
Welcome, but not necessary. What about passion?
Daisy inquired.
Decidedly unwelcome.
Intelligence?
Evangeline suggested. Annabelle shrugged.
Negotiable.
Charm?
Lillian asked.
Also negotiable.
You don't want much, Lillian remarked dryly.
As for me, I would have to add a few conditions. My peer would have to be dark-haired and handsome, a wonderful dancer, and he would never ask permission before he kissed me. I want to marry a man who has read the entire collected works of Shakespeare,
Daisy said.
Someone quiet and romantic. Better yet if he wears spectacles. And he should like poetry and nature. And I shouldn't like him to be too experienced with women.
Her older sister lifted her eyes heavenward.
We won't be competing for the same men, apparently.
Annabelle looked at Evangeline Jenner.
What kind of husband would suit you, Miss Jenner?
Evie,
the girl murmured, her blush deepening until it clashed with her fiery hair. She struggled with her reply, extreme bashfulness warring with a strong instinct for privacy.
I suppose I would like someone who was kind and...
Stopping, she shook her head with a self-deprecating smile.
I don't know. Just someone who would love me, truly love me.
The words touched Annabelle and filled her with sudden melancholy. Love was a luxury she had never allowed herself to hope for, a distinctly superfluous issue when her very survival was so much in question. However, she reached out and touched the girl's gloved hand with her own.
"I hope you find him," she said sincerely. "Perhaps you won't have to wait for long." "I want you to find yours first,"
Evie said, with a bashful smile.
"I wish I could help you somehow."
"It seems that we all need help in one form or another," Lillian commented. Her gaze slid over Annabelle with friendly speculation.
I wouldn't mind making a project of you." "What?"
Annabelle arched her brows, wondering whether she ought to be amused or offended. Lillian proceeded to explain.
"There are only a few weeks left in the season, and this is your last, I assume. Practically speaking, your aspirations of marrying a man who is your social equal will vanish at the end of June."
Annabelle nodded warily.
"Then I propose..."
Suddenly, Lillian fell silent in mid-sentence. Following the direction of her gaze, Annabelle saw a dark figure approaching, and she groaned inwardly. The intruder was Mr. Simon Hunt, a man whom none of them wanted anything to do with, and with good reason.
"Parenthetically," Annabelle said in a low voice, "my ideal husband would be the exact opposite of Mr. Hunt." "What a surprise,"
Lillian murmured sardonically, for they all shared the sentiment. One could forgive a man for being a climber if he possessed a sufficient quantity of gentlemanly grace. However, Simon Hunt did not. There was no making polite conversation with a man who always said exactly what he thought, no matter how unflattering or objectionable his opinions. Perhaps one might call Mr. Hunt good-looking. Annabelle supposed that some women might find his robust masculinity appealing. Even she had to admit that there was something compelling about the sight of all that bridled power contained in a crisp, formal scheme of black and white evening clothes. However, Simon Hunt's arguable attractions were completely overridden by the churlishness of his character. There was no sensitive aspect to his nature, no idealism or appreciation of elegance. He was all pounds and pence, all selfish, grasping calculation. Any other man in his situation would have had the decency to be embarrassed by his own lack of refinement. But Hunt had apparently decided to make a virtue of it. He loved to mock the rituals and graces of aristocratic civility, his cold black eyes glittering with amusement, as if he were laughing at them all. No doubt many people shared Annabelle's dislike of Simon Hunt, but to the dismay of London's upper tiers, he was there to stay. In the past few years, he had become incomparably rich, having acquired majority interests in companies that manufactured agricultural equipment, ships, and locomotive engines. Despite Hunt's coarseness, he was invited to upper-class parties because he was simply too wealthy to be ignored. Hunt personified the threat that industrial enterprise posed to the British aristocracy's centuries-old entrenchment in estate farming. Therefore, the peerage regarded him with concealed hostility, even as they unwillingly allowed him access to their hallowed social circles. Worse still, Hunt made no pretense at humility, but instead seemed to enjoy forcing his way into places where he wasn't wanted. Annabelle sensed the other Wallflowers' relief as Hunt ignored them and turned his attention exclusively to her.
"Miss Peyton," he said.
His obsidian gaze seemed to miss nothing. The carefully mended sleeves of her gown, the fact that she had used a spray of pink rosebuds to conceal the frayed edge of her bodice, the paste pearls dangling from her ears. Annabelle faced him with an expression of cool defiance.
"Good evening, Mr. Hunt."
"Will you favour me with a dance?" he asked without prelude.
"No, thank you."
"Why not?"
"My feet are tired."
One of his dark brows arched.
"From doing what? You've been sitting here all evening."
Annabelle held his gaze without blinking.
I have no obligation to explain myself to you, Mr. Hunt.
One wall shouldn't be too much for you to manage.
Despite Annabelle's efforts to stay calm, she felt a scowl tugging at the little muscles of her face.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.